most of the things that you see in the people are using, they are in chlorine-based disinfectant. What the issue with chlorine-based, this is smell, hospital implied, and environmental services to nurses, they don't like it. It's corrosive, it destroys the surfaces for nature. Residues leave impression of white salt and appears not clean, and long contact time, and this has hard time to chlorine-resistant microorganisms. So basically, all these problems are creating hospital-acquired infection. And U.S. government spends $70 to $80 billion per year, and that also results some several deaths. And here I'm coming and telling, why don't you use Ferrate 6? And why I am saying you can use Ferrate 6? Because you can see the example, these are the spores, some of the spores and organisms. This is numbers, and this is black one is untreated one. These are the numbers. And chlorine comes, doesn't work for this species. Aerobic spores bearer is basically anthrax type of species, but Ferrate is highly effective against it. And then chlorine is not effective with against sulfide reducing clostridia. But Ferrate is highly effective. So that means Ferrate can do better job in against some of the chlorine resistance organism, microorganism. So that's why we can do Ferrate we need. And in as a product, I basically have a patent on this one. And what this patent tells is basically historically Ferrate 6 in water solution is stable only for hours. That's why you don't see many applications yet. But then with the innovation, I have developed a solution like this, which is economically produced in less than hours and stable for at least 2 weeks. We have found it is basically in a couple of months, you can stabilize this solution for many applications. And what it can do, it can use in hospital as a surface disinfectant. So, like this is MRSA and chlorine deficient spores. It can do 6 log reduction in 2 minutes. That's the beauty, because that is the challenge, because if taking too long something, then in the market that you see is 10% bleach basically written outside the bottle of some of the consumer products, but here is not corrosive material and can do a little bit better job. And 2 minutes, so we are now in the process of getting EPA approval, and that, you know, is the federal government, so it will take a lot of time and a lot of money, but at least we, some companies that has taken it, and then they are going forward with this. So when it does the job, like if this virus is basically destroy proteins and genes, so it really doesn't come back. It's very important. You can destroy, you can scare it, but then it can repair it. In this case, the virus doesn't come back. Basically, we have damaged the protein. And then we have recently tested last year this norovirus. This norovirus has a problem because it has some visitors in Yosemite National Park. They got illness, so this is big problem here, and we were able to basically destroy this norovirus by adding the ferrate. And what is the big message so far is it can be disinfectant ferrate, and now I think we need to take to the next step, or somebody will publish soon if they haven't done yet. Can it do the same thing with the COVID virus? Answer is yes, but we need hard data, and only a few facilities in the nation can do this testing with the real one, but it will be effective against this virus too. And not only virus, even toxins can also be detoxified using ferrate. Here is the example of in microcystine. I don't know if you're familiar with this. Microcystine comes out from the algae. Some of the coastal environment you can see is getting green. And one time in Toledo water, they have a crisis for 2 weeks where people didn't have their water in their at home. They stopped the water because they found microcystine. Microcystine is basically this molecule, heptapeptide ring, and then some. This is the structure of microcystine. This, the double bond, is basically is neurotoxins. Double bond is the one that caused this neurotoxicity of this microcystine. And probably you heard a couple of cases in Florida, they have red tide. It also leaves microcystine type of toxins. What ferrate does is, this is a ferrate molecule, so it attacks a couple of places in this molecule and basically destroy this one. Spallies attack the double bond, so it is, first thing is, it is no more toxic. And we have even tested the toxicity after the attack, and then this double bond is destroyed by ferrate 6. And this is, ferrate can be, just to little bit back off with this slide, there are disinfection byproducts that comes out from chlorine. And some of the, there are so many actually, 1500, and the scientists are identifying only 700 to 800, but out of those 700 to 800, only 10s are monitored by EPA. So if these values, once they monitor, if the cities goes high value, they get punished. And out of this, these are the molecules that they trihalomethane, for example. So when they do this thing, they wash trihalomethane. But what we are suggesting, you, they can use basically ferrate before they chlorinate. And because you need chlorine to disinfect it, which can go to our tap water. And you can see having this process is basically decreasing this trihalomethane in water. And there are some other kind of disinfection byproducts, chloral hydrate and haloacetonitrile, they get also reduced if we follow ferrate pre-oxidation and subsequently do the chlorination. And so now I'm going to talk the examples of removing metals. So I talk disinfection, and that can do the bacteria, virus, and I talk so toxins detoxification. And let me talk about now arsenic. Arsenic is in two forms of oxidation state 3 and oxidation state 5. And in nature, this is the form that you find in arsenic 3, which is basically no charge. And when something is no charge, it's very difficult to remove because you need some interaction, adsorbent, so it can remove. So, but need to convert 3 to 5. And in this conversion from 3 to 5, basically you are creating some charged species, then easy to remove. And beauty of ferrate is it can oxidize because it's a powerful oxidant, convert to 5. And then RN3 that is produced there is has a high quality RN3, which can really remove arsenic 5 from the water. And that what you can see, arsenic is being removed. Okay. And the other beauty is this, which is detailed in written in these articles and later one too. Arsenic is captured in iron oxide nanoparticles or particles there inside. So it's basically encapsulate. So then it cannot release anymore this arsenic to the environment. And not only arsenic, there are some other metal, cobalt, nickel, copper, they can also be removed. And you can see they can, it can hide in the structure of RN3 that is, and that you can see here. And so we have done the mechanism of study on this one. And cadmium can also be removed. But cadmium is, doesn't go inside the structure, but definitely it has a strong adsorption. It can be removed from water. And then you may ask, what about lead? And if you see the chemistry and you're familiar with that is the news, what happened in Flint, Michigan, water flowing a faucet in a hospital in Flint, they have a high level of lead because they changed the chemistry to save money. And you can see pipes from the Flint water distribution system after the city decided to use water from the local Flint water. What it did basically, it put, because there are lead pipes there, if you use chlorine and some of the phosphate, it was fine situation. But the moment they changed the chemistry, you can read or you can send, if you are interested in detail, I will be happy to send you more information. And they basically release more lead. Then how basically ferrate can solve some of these problems? And we have done some study. Here basically we did ferrate 6 pre-treatment. That is strategy to decrease soluble lead in water. And these are basically disinfectant byproducts. These are toxic, as I was just mentioning before. So ferrate is basically decreasing the disinfection byproducts formation. But interesting thing is you can see ferrate, this is without ferrate, but once you have a ferrate, this is much, there's a lead release to the water or in the water is decreased at different pH. So we did the pH studies, 6, 7, and 8, and then you can see compared to this 45, now we have only 15. Here is we have 13, we have around 10. Here is we have 15, but now it's around 5. So basically every pH you see here, lead after the ferrate treatment is really reduced. It has been published now, so it's written in press, but it has been published and I think it came out in 21. So I would be happy to send, if you are interested, more details how this is done. And so now I shown examples so far of disinfection and removal of metals. Now I'm going to talk about how you can use its oxidative properties to remove antibiotics in water. And antibiotics in water is a World Health Organization, WHO, they are saying is urgent action to avoid antimicrobial resistance crisis. They think is one of the biggest global health crises that is of the century, having antibiotics around. Because what is happening is we are overusing it, we are living longer, and we are releasing too many antibiotics in the environment. And what does it do? That is bacteria becoming resistant. It's called antibiotic resistance. Bacteria and genes, so basically they are drug resistant. And that is the not a good position to be in a couple of years. That's the prediction of World Health Organization. So basically what I'm trying to convey, we need to remove antibiotics from water, okay? And ferrate can basically remove these antibiotics. You can see these antibiotics ferrate can remove in seconds time scale, these ones. And some of the other estrogens and phenolic estrogens, those can also be removed efficiently, you can see in seconds. But this whole removal is basically depends on the dose and the pH. For at least pH 7 and using 10 ppm dose of ferrate, we can remove in second time scale. And not only we are removing this antibiotics, we are basically making it not antibiotic anymore. So we have tested that one. So oxidized product, this is a technique by fluorescence. This light means here is becoming non-antibiotic. And so it is working fine. So ferrate has been tested a long time ago in wastewater treatment to remove these EDCs and PPCPs, personal pharmaceutical and personal care byproducts and estrogens chemicals. And you can see here, we have a good news and not too good news. The ferrate, for most of them, ferrate can remove up to 100%. This is different chemicals and its elimination is 100%, but some are not. So where the some are not, I like to make it 100%, which are low level. And how I'm going to do, this is the next last of the talk I'm going to emphasize in using the chemistry, which I already mentioned to you before, how I want to use this chemistry. We have ferrate 6, it is going to 5, 4, 3, and 2. And I already mentioned to you, 5 and 4 are much more reactive. And this is the example you can see with cyanide. This is the reaction of rate constant. This is the pH. And you can see 4 is much more reactive, 2-order magnitude. And then 5 is much more reactive. So how we can convert selectively or controlled fashion to 5 and 4, this 6? Or you may ask, maybe we can go this way. So here is, I'm talking about tuning the reactivity of 6. So we can exploit the chemistry of this to enhance, because something, as I already mentioned very early on, something that 6 is doing in minutes, 4 will do in seconds, and 5 will do in milliseconds. So that what the chemistry we want to apply to solve some of the difficult problems in treating water. And we have used, to explain this thing, we have used DFT calculation, where we explain basically the trend that you see here, or you can see here, 5 is much more reactive than 4. So we apply DFT to understand. And 4 and 5, I start calling activated ferrate. Ferrate there, but then you can activate it, and that's what my chemistry or research and some of the difficult problems that we are trying to solve lately, basically we are studying the activated ferrate to treat the water and treat the many other problems on the surfaces. So what, how we did this here, we added into 6 these different chemicals, acid, silica, ammonia, peroxy monosulfate, sulfite, and thiosulfate. In doing these things here, we are producing 4 and 5 immediately. And then we, in with this sulfur species, we are also producing some additional radicals. So what does it do? Before it was without these additions, we have removed, no reacting, but acid can increase removal to 40%, silica to 40%, and then peroxy monosulfate can increase to 60%. And sulfite and thiosulfate can do in to a, in 100%. And keep here, by just doing this thing, we are doing in 30 seconds. Okay? And that what activated ferrate can do. And this is the example we have tested in real wastewater. We also see enhanced removal by acid-activated ferrate 6. And you, in, this was tested in Canada water, and then it showed up. That means enhancement was seen in the acid activation. And we have done with thiosulfate, because thiosulfate is stable in water and commercially out there, you can get. And you can see in 30 seconds, basically, we are enhancing the removal of many, many chemicals, which are, some are antibiotics, some are pharmaceuticals, and some are pesticides that can be removed. So as an agriculture university you are in, this basically we can take care of the pesticides removal once it is applied, or how we can do it. So that's the message, another message I want to convey. And lately we have also done, last year it was published, we can use some of the surfaces, carbon-based surfaces, like graphene and graphite, fluorine, and hydrochar. And that also showed the enhancement by their addition, because iron 6 only and is not doing the job. But the moment you add different surfaces, it can enhance the removal. And that, what you can also see in this slide, how much enhancement is happening when you combine ferrate with hydrochar. So we are using the surface chemistry that is on the hydrochar or carbon material to make this enhancement possible. And now last 10 minutes that's left now, I'm going to talk, because I like to leave some time so you can ask me questions and discussion that I think Dean and Ali also advised me to have a discussion. So this is NSF proposal that basically end in September 1st, where we try to solve the problems of antibiotics. Antibiotics are coming from the urine, okay? And urine enter into the wastewater water. What we propose here, and that you can remove pharmaceuticals and antibiotics by in the urine itself, before it goes to wastewater or go to the environment or go to the river, by adding ferrate. What does ferrate does is basically it can attack the antibiotics. And fortunately, ferrate does not attack the urea present in the urine. So once it doesn't do that, then we can basically recover the urea. So basically we can recovering the nutrients and creating the fertilizer. So basically removing antibiotics and recovering the energy there, nitrogen recovery. And this is to show what is in, then we study the chemistry, we can do it. But then exciting thing is how it can help the urine, even enhancing it. I already showed you one slide where I said you can add these many additives, you can make an enhancement. But urine contains some of the components which can enhance it. And what we found is ammonia. You can see over here, ammonia is enhancing. More and more ammonia you have, so you don't need to add anything. Urine is already has ammonia, it will do the job of activating the ferrate. Same thing we found, carbonate that is present there is also enhanced. And some of the organics like chitidine also enhances it. And I'm going to show some examples. What I mean, if we have ferrate bicarbonate ammonia, this is the ammonia, this is without ammonia, and then you can see how ammonia is enhancing it, the removal of some of these pharmaceuticals. This is TMP, trimethoprim, and sulfamethoxazole. These are the ones they always find in sulfur drugs. They are combined together, so they are always have in our water, wastewater. So that's why we were interesting this thing here. You can see how TMP enhancement by just having ammonia there, and to certain extent, carbonate is there. Like for SMX, you can see how much enhancement is happening when carbonate is around. And then it is followed by chitinine, I mentioned, and that chitinine also showed this one enhancement for TMP and also for SMX. And these are the nitrogen-containing molecules. And out of these other organics did not do much, but definitely chitinine already present in urine, it can enhance. So that's the beauty, turned out to the beauty of our research, We don't need to add additives, but we can control the chemistry by just having the constituents, those are present in urine. So we are removing the pharmaceuticals, we are removing this thing, nitrogen recovery, at the same time we are enhancing the chemistry of ferrate. And recently, just paper get accepted in EST water, ACS EST water, where we basically did some other amines, because amines are showing some effect. These amines are also present in wastewater, contribute to disinfection byproducts. So we could use the chemistry of this with six, and we found dimethylamine. This is monomethylamine, ethylamine, and then we have—
Yes.
Continue, please.
Okay. So, and that can also show enhancement 77%, motomethylamine 30%, and 22% is. So, there is a trend. So, we use DFT calculation to really explain this trend. And that where we found the energy, activation energy, also at the end, delta G actually, not activation. This trend basically explains why we are seeing dimethylamine giving the highest percentage of removal. And very recently, we have another project in collaboration with Georgia Tech. We start using peracetic acid with ferrate. And because peracetic acid is recently, they start using as a disinfectant. This is emerging disinfectant. Chemistry is known for several decades ago, but they were never applied in the water treatment or even in hospital, but they are doing it. So we would get interested. What happened is ferrate is combined with peracetic acid. Amazingly, it can also do similar things. What we are trying to do, it can remove so many pharmaceuticals to up to 100%. By having the two oxidant or two disinfectant together. And this paper just get accepted on Monday. And we are very happy about it. And so in conclusion, basically my intention was to give you some feeling. So then if you, some of your students or if you like to collaborate, and then we can go more details how we can do it. And this is close university, close from our university. Your student can spend some time in summer or we can do regular basis even during the regular semester. I can come over there or you can send students over here. So ferrate, beauty of ferrate is this is, it can do disinfection, coagulation, and also oxidation in just one chemical. The things that I did not talk is because it is selective oxidant, you can perform some organic synthesis. And it was proposed as a superion battery because six is going to three. So it's a three electron, you can store more energy. And you can combine with the light to get more effect. And this is, we gave the accounts of our research in this 15. And after 15, we have written some more update, and which is just going to the revision for a journal. And after that, we basically discuss what happened last 5 years in this ferrate oxidation. So my dream is still the same thing, how to manage the chemistry of ferrate, so we can enhance the decontamination of water. So even developing countries, we have, for example, we have lemon and water and some ferrate, it can just do the job. And we have also recently find that lemon can do also similar job of activation. So basically it can really purify water, but need to take from the lab chemistry to real world, so even in developing countries, and it can even use in emergency preparation for soldiers, disaster like Houston is happening and people need in a short time. some purified water, you just add the ferrate and just lemon there, and it is safe to drink. Even rural communities, that is, I think, is one need to pay attention, which I like to talk with Dr. Ali, how we can really Texas community or even international, because rural community really needs help to get some pure water. It can prevent waterborne disease in developing country and basically address the global health using ferrate technology. And I have written books or edited, not written book, edited. And you can see this is ferrate here, then update in later years. So these are collaborators from Taiwan, Korea, and this is Rajendra Verma from EPA here in Cincinnati, and also Dion is also University of Cincinnati. And we have a Moss Bauer book co-edited, because iron chemistries can be studied by Moss Bauer technique. My co-editors were from Germany, Gostar Klinkhofer, and he's the one actually developed the technique which can determine what kind of iron is present in Mars. So his instrument went to the vehicle in the Mars, so we can study the iron. And this is Professor Nishida from Japan. And this is a book I have authored the book. And out of that book, I created the endowment. Some money was made on this book, not much. It's to create endowment towards a graduate student chemistry with preference in first generation who excel in research through high impact journal article publication. And every year the student get award from this endowment in respect to my late mother. And there are some other books of sustainable nanotechnology and environment and nanomaterials and emerging environment and green catalysts for energy transformation and emission controls. And with this, I'd like to thank my collaborators and funding National Science Foundation and Dr. Jinadatta from VA Hospital in Temple, who did the disinfection, surface disinfection work with me in hospital, and some of these other collaborators throughout the year, Ajay Ray from Ontario and Radik is from Czech Republic. And then recently I'm collaborating a lot with Professor Ma from Texas A&M. And here is my next year slide. The next Mr. slide will be Professor Ali and Professor Ravi Motar and me, Professor Ray. So many other colleagues in ferrate research. With this, I say thank you and welcome any question. I think I made it on time in 45 minutes, so I encourage all of you to ask many, many questions to me.
Well, thank you, Professor Sharma, for a very good and excellent presentation. I give overview of several topics that are really very, very interesting to the area of public health and water quality. And so I think it's a good discussion from here, and we're through a pandemic. So I think lots of these topics are very vivid in our memory. So the floor is open, and I think I see our Dean. I mean, if you have anything, Dean D'Souza, please go ahead.
Oh yes, Ali, you know I will. Matter of fact, I have so much, it may take up more time than my allotment. But first of all, I want to say, Dr. Sharma, thank you very much. It's a topic that is of great interest. Even though I'm an economist by training, I make it my business to know about all of the natural resources out there, soil and water and air and so on. And water is something that is essential for life. The quality and quantity represent existential threats through climate change, climate extremes, and so on. And of course, water quality, and as you rightly pointed out, the antibiotics in the water stream. And I remember Cousteau back in the day talking about this whole cycle. You consume an aspirin, it ends up in the toilet, ends up in the ocean, and then it comes back, you know, part of the water cycle. So the antibiotic increase, including with the COVID pandemic, I'm sure has created havoc with the drinking water stream. You talked about water and some of the books. I also wanted to show off a book that somebody by the name of Ferris has recently co-authored, and it's called Arsenic Water Resources Contamination, Challenges and Solutions. So we have a few scientists, including Dr. Ferris, who are very prolific writers, and I applaud them for their contributions, scholarly contributions, but also in the classroom. So so that is just one of several books that Dr. Ferris has written on the topic, and some of our other scientists and faculty also have publications in this area. So kudos to that. And finally, I do want to say hello to my colleagues out there. It's pleased to see 30 participants. We had 10 or 12 at the start. So thanks for joining in. This is very important. It's been renamed the Land Grant Seminar Series. So as Dr. Ferris mentioned, anyone and everyone is welcome to present on something, and hope we have a waiting line. So research, extension, and academics, as well as maybe at some point staff presentation, postdocs, technicians, farm staff, those kinds of things. So really it is inclusive and open to everyone. And Dr. Sharma, once again, thank you and welcome to campus at some point. And we look forward to ways to collaborate.
And thank you for the kind words. So I'm very glad I got this opportunity, and I work on nanoparticles, microplastic. If you don't find any professor to fill the slot, I'm here. I'm more than happy to fill the gap if you need me, Professor Fierce.
Definitely, we're looking forward for many areas. And I think we have Dr. Carson, who works on several close area. I think she can, if she's around here, maybe also she can connect with you. She has been doing on in the area of similar to what you are doing there. So so we have few people who are working in different area. Water happened to be one of them, but as you see, and as you covered in your topic, your area of interest is very wide across multiple areas of health and agriculture and so on. So I think we're very pleased to do that. So colleagues, please go ahead and engage our speaker today. Benefit of his knowledge and experience, and challenge him with your insightful questions. I think maybe I can.
Ali?
Go ahead. Ali? Okay, Laura, go ahead, please.
Yeah, I have a question. Dr. Sharma, it was a very, very enlightening talk. And I look forward to meeting you. My question is related to the percent yields of your reactions. So you showed a number of slides where there were reactions going on. Yeah. So what were your yields like?
You means once we react ferrate with the pharmaceuticals, you mean?
Right.
So first thing is we are removing the 100% those pharmaceuticals. The one I showed, that means we are removing 100%.
Okay.
And other thing is we do look for oxidized products. And what we have found, those oxidized products are also non-toxic.
Okay.
So that's where we finish everything. Mm-hmm. We don't quantify those products because many are unknown. So you don't get standards. So then you cannot quantify. I just want to mention antibiotics, which Dean mentioned. It does come back to our waters without even know. In bottled water in Europe and some places here, they have found antibiotics, even drinking bottles that you pay and get the pure water, but you end up seeing the antibiotics there. So without knowing, you may be taking some antibiotics. And so that is the case. So thank you, Laura, for asking the question. Please, if we didn't answer it, I'll try one more time.
Okay, no problem. That's great.
I think if you may want to expand a little bit on what you do, she's working on polymers, and I think it's very relevant to what you do in microplastic, I guess.
So I've done some work with polymers, biodegradable polymers, specifically like chitosan. You know, that one's part of, it's one of those compounds that's present in the shell of shellfish. Mm-hmm. I've done some work with that. And there's a lot of research out there as it relates to chitosan and water waste.
Mm-hmm. I published a review articles on just a couple of months ago, microplastic and nanoplastics. Mm-hmm. So I'll be happy to send you, or you look and see if we have mutual interest there. Because okay. My interest is moving. I work a lot with nanoparticles before, and now I think similar things that I'm taking that research to nanoplastic and microplastic. Mm-hmm. And I'm chemistry, interested in chemistry of that, how that is interacting with the soil, for example. Because
mm-hmm.
Eventually it is going to come to us.
Yeah.
Because it will enter into food. And actually, it has already been stated in some papers that is coming back to us through food.
But do you think that the size of those nanoplastics, if you're using it in fields, that it could some kind of way enter into the food chain?
Yes, yes. That I'm trying to convey. We know nanoparticles turn into in our food.
Yeah.
And we like to cover through plastic everything.
Yes, we do. Yes, we do.
So those are releasing. If you put in a sunlight, they are degrading.
That's right.
And that is basically slowly, it is totally new area, actually.
Mm-hmm.
That's why I'm so excited about this thing here. Besides ferrate, I work a lot with ferrate. I think I just now getting close to bringing to the reality in commercial things. But there is many other properties and out-of-box kind of things the ferrate can address.
Mm-hmm.
Some of the, in agriculture things, we didn't even think right now.
Right.
And then is microplastics.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah, that sounds good. We should talk.
Yes, should talk. Laura, I will, or Dr. Carson, if I don't allow me to say Laura.
It's okay. Laura's fine.
Okay. I'm looking forward very much. It's just 40 minutes where I live in south part of College Station. It's just 40 minutes. And there is very nice Italian restaurants just on the highway 280. Maybe we should talk over lunch.
Right, we should do that. Yeah, I've been to College Station several times.
Yeah. Well, you are welcome to come and see my lab too, and public health school.
Okay, great.
Yeah, please make a point to visit us.
Okay.
Yeah.
We will do that, yes.
And we can go also for a nice lunch.
That'd
all
be
right.
Great.
We have another question here online. The question says, thank you for your interesting talk. Can you please give more detail about the activation mechanism for ferrate by amines?
Yes, what the question is, we have studied this amines, and in these papers, when we publish EST papers, and because our aim is always to publish EST, that is the best in the game. Environmental Science Technology, that's considered number one journal. And so there, if you're interested in mechanism, we have provided a lot of details in this paper. And even other amines, which I just mentioned, we went even took the DFT calculation approach to go after the mechanism. So how that is really happening? Initially, ferrate 6 is coming close to the amines, forming some kind of complex, and oxygen atom from the ferrate is being transferred. So it is forming RN4. And then RN4 is basically reacting with these formsticles like TMP to really enhance the oxidation. So I'll be happy to talk individually with you if you want some Zoom talk. And there are some paper we published where we are really detailed mechanism we have given to in those papers.
Okay. So, I have one question. Good morning.
Good morning. Yes, go ahead, Ramray.
Okay, so Dr. Sharma, thanks for your great presentation and being here.
Thank you. Thank you for the kind words.
So we have been discussing several things about the application of your work in agriculture. So can you summarize that how your work will be very much interesting or applicable in agriculture?
Yes, because I don't want, first thing is you improve the water quality, okay? And then in agriculture, good quality water basically improved a lot. And that means by you improve the soil properties, and there are many other applications which I can talk with you later, because we just filed a provisional to show patent to demonstrate how it can improve the quality of food products and using the ferrate. And so we don't know the mechanism, but it really improved the quality, or it's improved the, because it'd be very simple term, let me explain just in one or two sentences, then you can ask me question. I already showed you bacteria and virus you can remove. So all the food get, or vegetables and fruit get destroyed by these species. So if you can remove those species, then they basically, they have a long shelf life. So that way I see, and some of the diseases, for example, in Florida, these oranges, basically oranges, the trees are disappearing, and because the disease there. And question is, can we use ferrate to cure those oranges? Or in any trees or any kind of disease that is there in agriculture that can help by ferrate. Other question is, can we replace the toxic pesticide using iron-based molecule? So these are the some of the examples I gave, and I'll be happy to talk more in details. So then you can see what I'm going with it.
I think we have a question from Adesi. Please go ahead, Adesi.
Yeah, can you hear me?
Yes, we can.
Okay. First of all, thank you, Dr. Sharma, for your nice presentation. I have a question on one of the application of the ferrate, which is cleaning the lake. So how do you just relate the action of the ferrate with the biologics of the microcystic? How you just explain the action of ferrate with the biology of the micro system?
Yes. How it is killing it? That's the question, and I apologize. Yeah. I didn't understand completely.
Okay. Because I'm far.
Okay. If your question is how ferrate is killing microcystine, it's just some of the molecules, organic functional groups or groups present in microcystine, which has a heptapeptide ring and some double bond and some this here, ferrate is tend to react with those groups. So ferrate basically attack those groups. And then that way destroyed those microcystine. If that is your question, or you can repeat if this other question, then I will answer that question. Please.
It seems he's pleased with your answer, and I would like to maybe, if there is no question, I'd like to ask about the potential for this. There is another message. Who's okay? I'm curious to know if you have done any work as it relates to the impact of Superfund sites on water and air quality. This is from, go ahead.
Well, personally, I did not. I somehow didn't click. I did not click with the market, this the Superfund side. If you have any opportunity, I would love. I would love to go to that or collaborate, or they can integrate my chemistry in the Superfund site to improve the quality. Answer is in very simple. I haven't worked myself, but I wish to do that.
Thank okay, you. That was my question. Enjoyed your presentation. Great, great, thought provoking. And I know that was a big issue some years ago in the area, in the area of Prairie View, in and around the surrounding areas, surrounding counties. And in recent years, I haven't heard anything about it, you know, and I'm just wondering, you know, is that a forgotten issue? I don't think so.
No. Is it that sometime is that's the way science goes? What is the new thing? It keep moving without solving the previous one.
Right.
So maybe in fall in that category.
Okay. Well, I think one question would be, I guess we can close with it. I think I see lots of interest and applications here, as you mentioned, in disaster, where people need to have access to clean water quickly and so on. There is room for innovation because you need. Yeah, how can you deliver this into a practical way? Can you elaborate a little bit more, please?
Yes, you are absolutely true. When Dean mentioned his economics with the knowing all this thing, we need, Ferrate need these kind of people, actually, honestly speaking. We are happy, scientists are happy just publishing paper and sometimes get patent. They think having a patent is done. It's not. Less than 2% patent get commercialized. And I think I historically or intentionally or I focus a lot in the lab, but somebody else who are the experts like the dean or some other expert, take my molecule, what I've done, and take to the market. And I think I will not do this good job. So I so far I'm staying out of it. So in terms of, because just give to the job which people can do. Much, much better job and more efficient. So I think that what the social people like Ferrate is there, but how they are going to take? Can we make a tea bag out of it, for example? And then people just have those tea bags, put in a water with lemon, and that's done. But this is what really economics involve, engineers involve, and some social people law communication is also important. One bad name is gauze, is no good, means no good, even it is a wonderful chemical. So communication becomes very, very important, psychologically, social. So it's not just developing technology in the lab. It doesn't go anywhere. It is only 15 to 20%, in my opinion. 80% is just people who are not in the lab. So I'm hoping, and some are already started some commercialization, those people will come and take this molecule and run with it and just need some business people, basically.
Well, I'd like to conclude here the seminar. We're beyond the 12. I think some of us need to go and have lunch, and some will have other things that to do. So I'd like to close by, and I'd like to give you the last opportunity for you before we close, to close out your talk, and we go from there.
Yes, I think his first thing is I like the dean and his team for giving me up, and also Professor Ferris to give me the opportunity to interact with the people here. That's, I think, that what Ferret needs more and more, to how this Ferret can solve real problems. So first thing, this is one of the opportunity and how I can take this to help some problems in even agriculture, land-based universities and collaborate with, that was my second goal. I think I accomplished, I feel that way I accomplished that. And last thing is I'm very open and invite all of you to come and visit me. And with this, I think is there are many opportunities. I hope we can collaborate in future to take this research to the even next level.
Well, thank you, Dr. Sharma. Thank you, everybody, for participating. I'd like to encourage you to please consider participating in this series. We still have some opening there that you can reach out to me, and please, I would like to hear from you guys. We are good about the great things that you are doing. Even if it is half done, that's okay. I mean, we might give you some ideas on how to improve it and how to make it better, etc. Even if you have a proposal, it's a good idea to discuss it with us. We'll be happy to give you that opportunity to talk and share with your knowledge. Again, Dr. Sharma, thanks a lot. Thank you, everybody. And have a great rest of the day.
Thank you. Bye-bye. Bye-bye. Thank you.
Thank you. Bye-bye.